The Bible Treasury, New Series. N11. A Monthly Magazine of Papers on Scriptural Subjects. Volume 31, Article 26, 1916 and 1917. Part 1 of 4. The Institution of the Lord's Supper as Recorded in the Gospels. Notes of an Address on Matthew 26 verses 26 to 28, Mark 14 verses 22 to 24, Luke 22 verses 19 and 20. W. J. Hocking. It is a striking circumstance that in the New Testament we have very few ordinances of any sort prescribed for the believer. We have baptism, and we have the Lord's Supper, but nothing besides. This absence of ritual is in great contrast with the religion of the Jews. Under the Mosaic law, there were many sacrifices to be offered daily, and throughout each day, and these sacrifices were of many kinds. There was a gorgeous and ornate building in which men were to worship. There were priests specially delegated for the purpose of ministering in the holy things and in the holy place and in the various holy services. There were also the Levites with definite duties in the temple precincts. There was in short a great host of rites and ceremonies to be performed. But when we come to the New Testament, we find that this order of things disappears, and that worship in spirit and in truth takes the place of worship by rote. The Lord's Supper is mentioned definitely in a few places only, but always in the simplest language, while the service itself is distinguished by its simplicity. There is nothing difficult in its observance, there is nothing costly in the bread and the wine which constitute the supper. They are just inexpensive articles within the reach of all. There is no priesthood, as distinct from assembly, authorized for its administration, and the prescribed ritual, if we may call it so, is very simple indeed. Christ himself, not shadows of him. Why is there this striking contrast? There may be many reasons, but I would like this evening to mention only one, which I think may be sufficient for the occasion. Under the law, the sacrifices and the services of the priesthood all pointed down the Old Testament ages to one who was coming, and who was to do the great and sufficient work of making an end of sins and of introducing righteousness. But in the New Testament, we find that person has made his advent into the world, and has accomplished the work of redemption. Moreover, he makes his presence known and felt in connection with this simple service. And when you have the substance, will you care for the shadow? When you have the antitype, where is the need for the type? The Lord's Supper brings the hearts of the children of God into close and living association with the person of the Lord Jesus Christ himself, and having him, all legal symbolism is superseded, as the Epistle to the Hebrews shows in great detail. It is the Lord, then, who gives the supper its essential character, and therefore he is able to make his own people recognize his presence under the most adverse and difficult circumstances. They may be scattered and separated, they may be persecuted, but wheresoever they may be in the wide world, let them only be gathered to his name, let them but be desirous to do this in remembrance of him, and he is there in the midst, and his presence amply compensate for every other disability. The presence of Christ himself enables the believer to rise superior over all outward circumstances, whatever they may be. I know that eating the supper is not individual communion, and we will, perhaps, touch upon that part of the subject later. But it should be clearly understood by all that no person can properly enter into the meaning of the Lord's Supper, and that no Christian can experience the blessed fullness and joy of its observance apart from the recognition of the presence of Christ himself, verily in the midst according to his word, not cognizant to the senses, it is true, but cognizant in spite of the senses. Oftentimes there are matters arising in connection with the observance of the Lord's Supper which may tend to distract or turn away the heart and the thought from the subject of the moment, but when Christ's presence is realized all these things lose their influence, and dwarf into their proper insignificance. The circumstances of the institution. It is interesting to look at the institution of this supper with particular reference to the circumstances under which it was inaugurated. This will help us, I think, to gain a view, a right view, of this memorial and of its spiritual import. It was upon the eve of the great climax, shall I say, in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ that this supper was instituted. He had been in this world, the Son incarnate, passing through its varied scenes, the wonder of the angels, and the scorn of men. What that passage through this world meant to him we shall never know. But there was always before him during his ministry that crisis to which he alludes as his hour. There was an hour, a fixed moment, to which he was advancing. Everything concerning him had been prearranged, all the events were determined beforehand, and he knew the future. He was never taken by surprise, as we are, but consciously facing the difficulties, the sorrows, the agonies of Calvary, he went forward, unchanged in heart and purpose and action by what he knew was coming. His love never diminished in the slightest, his works of mercy were never left undone because of the greater work of atonement before him, but with imperturbable grace, he proceeded continuously day after day, night after night, in pursuance of his lowly service. His days were filled with beautiful expressions of heavenly love in this dark and evil world, set forth for man's faith and knowledge. But when he drew near to Calvary, he was in the very shadows of that oppressive darkness which enveloped him on the cross. And it was on the eve of his departure from this world that he instituted the supper. On the Passover night itself, on that night so full, too, of events of universal importance, he instituted the supper. You will remember that he was together with his disciples in the upper room expressly to keep the Passover supper. The company was Jesus and the 12. They were 12 distinguished men, but distinguished in a special manner. They had been called out to be his apostles, his beloved followers and his witnesses. They were selected to see more of his face than any in the world besides, to hear more of his words than others, and to be admitted by him into scenes of closest intimacy. Disciples contending for precedence. The disciples were around the table, and Jesus at the head, looking upon them, as, indeed, he is looking now upon us, he saw all that was within them, and Scripture records that during that memorable night they showed that they were men of like passions with ourselves, changeable, unreliable, sometimes impulsive in love and earnest zeal, and at other times carried away by foolish and wicked thoughts. The disciples should have known what was before their master. Only a few days previous Jesus had said to the 12, "We go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests, and they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him unto the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify," Matthew 20 verses 17 to 19. That the Jews and Gentiles would unite in his crucifixion and death, he told them on three occasions. You would have thought that their interest and expectation of these events would have been quickened on that night, the Passover night. What did the blood of the Lamb signify? Did it not recall the hour of judgment and death passed long ago in Egypt? Had they considered the Lord's words seriously, would they not have entered that room with solemn hearts and chastened spirits? Would they not have been filled with a foreboding sense of sorrow and pain before their beloved Master? We find, however, that they were engaged in petty quarrels, struggling among themselves as to who should be greatest amongst them. Observing, I suppose, the disciple whom Jesus loved taking the place nearest to him, their jealousy was aroused. Why should he be there? Why not they? What was this painful altercation to our Lord? He was contemplating the morrow when he would bear their sins in his own body on the tree, just such sins as these. They could not understand his loving purpose. They were unable to enter into the grief before him. Such lack of spiritual feeling was the sorrowful result after 3 years' service with them. There was for him no comforter, no sympathizer, none that cared. Do not let us judge them too harshly, let us rather judge ourselves. Are we never guilty of the indulgence of unworthy thoughts at the table of the Lord? In the most solemn moments, when the Spirit of God is making to live again before us the hour of suffering at Calvary, thoughts may even then arise in our hearts, altogether out of harmony with the subject of the Spirit of God. We must know that we ought to bow our heads in shame when our Lord looks round upon us as we are eating his supper, because things are sometimes in our hearts which ought never to be there at such a holy season. The service of Jesus at the supper. Jesus rose from the table, he laid aside his garments, he girded himself with a towel, knowing, as the beloved apostle said, that the Father had given all things into his hands, that he had come from God, and was going to God. He then went round as the servant of them all to wash their feet. Was not this a sight to move their hearts? The Lord of glory, whom angels delighted to serve, was there meekly serving 12 men of humble birth, Peter, James, John, and Judas too. The Son of God had come down to serve them all. I am among you as he that serveth. The word, the act, form a rebuke for us all. Let us remember that on no occasion in our spiritual experience do we see the glory of humility exhibited more than at the Lord's Supper. That loaf, that wine, what do they tell us? Of the one who came down from above to serve, of the one who did serve in life and death, of the one who went under the cloud of wrath to serve, and to the death of the cross and into the grave to serve. Let us, then, never be ashamed to serve this Christ, for has he not served us, even to the death of shame? Jesus and Judas. All these circumstances are associated with the institution of the supper, which forms a contrast in its calm beauty with what was around him in Jerusalem, and what was before him on the morrow. In the little company itself, there was willfulness as well as weakness. One was altogether divided in interests from the Lord. For Judas was there. Ye are clean, says the Lord, but not all. In the little circle, there was this spectacle of direct apostasy before the eyes of our Lord. This man had been able to withstand the benign rays of heavenly glory shed directly upon him for 3 years. His heart was not softened by the ministry of grace but hardened. The love of Jesus had never penetrated his soul. It had, on the contrary, become a stronghold of sin, of shameful deeds, of Satan himself. The betrayal was an exhibition of the power of Satan, overcoming one in that small apostolic band. The Lord appealed to the traitor. He gave him the sop, and Judas took it but withstood the overture. All the love of Christ was thrown away upon him, his soul was completely devastated and ruined. That thou doest, the Lord said, do quickly. Then he arose from the table and went out, and Scripture adds, it was night. He went out into the blackness of night's darkness to do a deed of blacker darkness. Judas was at the table, but went out from the presence of the Lord, to go to his own place. He was not clean, as the Lord had said. But he having gone, the Lord, as they were eating, took bread and the wine, and instituted the supper. This done, he went on to speak those valedictory words we have, and which we love so much, in the Gospel of John. These discourses speak, not of the forgetfulness on the part of the disciples, not of the evil within them, but to their hearts which were full of love for him, and of sorrow, because he was about to leave them. He knew that they truly loved him, he knew that in spirit they were prepared to renounce everything for him. He knew that they were exposed to danger and that they were feeble in action but fearless in spirit. He said, I am going away. You are filled with sorrow. I know that you love me. I know that you will lament when I am gone from you, but I will come to you again. So he brightened the future for them by the promise of his return, and thus buoyed them up with the glorious hope of his returning, having first taught them the remembrance of himself in the supper. All these circumstances tend to give a special character to the supper of the Lord. They all combine in an appeal to our affections that we should value its observance. There is no engagement more solemn or serious, and nothing more blessed as a spiritual occupation. I do not know what we can do or say that calls for more earnest examination of our own hearts than the participation in this feast. Yet the service is simple and accessible, and, while we are assured of the Lord's presence, there are no terrors set before us as there were at Sinai, no clouds of darkness, no thunderings or lightnings. On the contrary, we have the sweet and loving invitation of the Lord himself, this do in remembrance of me. The Lord took bread and blessed. Now let us notice for a little the actual institution of the supper by our Lord. The details are all familiar to us who are present, no doubt. While the disciples were eating, the Lord took bread. This act was not associated with the ritual of the Passover supper, it was an act quite separate, of course, and quite distinct from it. The Passover supper was kept, The ceremony was maintained in the prescribed form, and then the Lord instituted a new supper, and one that would supersede it, because the Passover was about to be fulfilled by the sacrifice of our Lord himself, and having been fulfilled, it disappears, as it were, from the round of appointed feasts. The Lord took of the bread that was before him, and he blessed. We do not read that he blessed it. You will observe that the word "it" is in italics in our version, and therefore the significance is not that he took a piece of bread, and made it something else. He did not transform it. He blessed. He blessed God. He recognized the giver. His heart went up, as he loved it should, in thanksgiving to him that was above. No occasion too great, none too small, for each and all things he would bless and would give thanks. If you compare the account in Luke with those in Mark and Matthew, you will find that in Luke the parallel words are, "when he had given thanks." Blessing, therefore, is equivalent to giving thanks. There is no support at all in Scripture for the notion that the bread mysteriously and wonderfully became something different from what it was before. The Lord blessed, as we find he did on other occasions. It was a relief to him to look upwards. He could find nothing of joy in what was around him, but he could turn to God, and to the joy set before him. His link with the Father was close, his fellowship was intimate and precious. It was his habit to look up and give thanks. There is no doubt that there is more involved in the act than the mere giving of thanks for the reception of the bread. There was about to be sacrifice and bloodshedding, and both were before the holy soul of our Lord. This bread was to be his body. It had long been before him to do this deed of redeeming love.